Thanks to Brilliant for supporting my channel. If you watched sci-fi movies in the 70s and 80s, you would think that we'd all be driving autonomous cars by now. Or I guess none of us would be driving at all. Human driving would be obsolete. And while we have made some progress towards that goal, it's 2020 and most of us are still driving our own cars ourselves. From Tesla to Waymo, there's been a lot of work in getting us to the point where we can have fully autonomous cars, but in the process of developing machine learning models to do that, we've encountered some challenges. In fact, several of the big challenges stem from the fact that machine learning models for autonomous driving tend to be, well, big. And at first glance, that probably doesn't sound like a bad thing. After all, you would need a model that can capture the hundreds of thousands or millions of scenarios that we encounter while we're driving our own cars, and that would understandably be a pretty big model. On top of that, we need our model to capture things that have recently happened while we're driving, so that if you need to move out of the way of an oncoming car, you know that someone's not trying to merge into the lane next to you. It's sort of like GPT-3, but for autonomous driving. And speaking of GPT-3, I posted a video about that last Monday and actually ended up getting API access on Friday, so expect another video on GPT-3, I guess. Anyways, the problem is that the larger these models get, the less we're able to understand about how they make decisions during the driving process, which is important for a lot of reasons, namely that if something goes wrong, we want to know what and how we can fix it. After all, it's hard to fix a model if you don't know what's broken. And scaling down our models might help us understand them because there are fewer variables at play, but we also wouldn't be able to capture all of those driving experiences the model might counter along the way, right? Maybe not. You see, a recent Nature paper took a different approach to the challenge of autonomous driving by modeling their network after the brain network of a worm called C. elegans. And surprisingly, using a total of 19 neurons, that model performed a lot better than some of the bigger models did. Why? Well, let's get into it. When it comes to developing machine learning models for autonomous driving, we're usually talking about end-to-end models where we train a model to predict how the steering wheel should turn or how the brake pedal should move in response to video data or image frames that it's seeing in real time. And these models tend to perform well when we test them on other types of driving video as well as in simulations, but when it comes to live road tests, they often fail. There are a lot of reasons for this, but one of the big ones is the fact that unlike problems like winning the game Go or beating a video game, the task of driving is a fairly open-ended problem. In other words, in the game Go, it is possible to simulate every possible outcome given the pieces on a current board, whereas when it comes to driving, that's just not possible to do. This means that no matter how much training data you show a model, you're always going to have a situation that the model might encounter that it's never seen before, and so far, we're not great at developing models that handle those situations well. Additionally, end-to-end models for autonomous driving tend to learn causal relationships or cause and effect relationships that don't necessarily bear out in real life, but that worked well for the training data it saw. And as is a problem for many types of machine learning models, we tend to train our models on clean data, data that we've fixed to make it easier for the model to learn from. But the data that these models encounter in real life isn't clean, it's noisy and dirty, and slight changes that we as human drivers tend to disregard, something like a change in the lighting or a sunbeam or snow, the model doesn't learn how to handle. There's also the fact that, God forbid, if an autonomous car were to ever be in an accident, it needs to remember what recently happened in order to inform its next steps. We as humans naturally do this. We remember the last several seconds of the driving experience so that if you suddenly need to swerve, you have enough contextual memory in order to do so. However, it turns out that a lot of the machine learning models that we've developed to deal with this kind of time series data are actually better at remembering longer term trends, things that don't change over long periods of time, as opposed to things that change in recent memory. So what makes worm brains better than these massive models that we've used so far? Well, similar to our own brains, it turns out that the neurons in C. elegans encode way more information than the average perceptron in a neural network does. In fact, for an animal with a relatively simple nervous system, C. elegans are able to move around, navigate, and perform motor control. And because of that, the authors of this paper thought that approaching the task of autonomous driving from the perspective of a worm brain might actually make more sense than approaching it from the perspective of deep learning. Now, it's important to note that for this paper, the main task that the authors were focused on is lane keeping, or making sure that your car stays within lane, and so crashing or a failure of the task usually refers to a car veering out of lane into the sides of the road for the images. And obviously that's not the sum total of all of the tasks that we encounter when we're driving our cars, especially when you think about big challenges in autonomous driving, like driving in cities where things are much more unpredictable and happen at a moment's notice. However, the authors did find that in using the approach of the Seligman's brain network, which they term a neural control policy, their model is able to perform better than several much larger models that in theory encode a lot more information. In particular, they find that neural control policies perform a lot better when you change images by adding things like noise or a simulated light beam, allowing the car to stay on the lane instead of veering off into the side of the road. They also find that neural control policies, or NCPs, are a lot more certain of the decision that ends up keeping them on the road than these other larger models. And this is good for us because while a larger model might predict that the best option is to stay on the road or turn the steering wheel in a particular way, if the difference between that and veering off the road into a tree is 0.05%, that's not a great vote of confidence. Lastly, NCPs are a lot more interpretable, which we've talked about in other videos on this channel, which is to say that we can understand how they end up making decisions a lot more easily than these bigger models. In particular, the different neurons in this model adopt different roles in the actual decision-making process, which are surprisingly similar to the way that Seligman's brains work, so that's pretty cool. Specifically, some neurons handle certain types of turns, some neurons handle speeding up versus slowing down, and some neurons handle the actual process of turning the wheel of the car. In short, this paper takes an interesting approach to the challenge of autonomous driving, although it obviously cannot be generalized to the entire task of autonomous driving. After all, we're only dealing with staying in a lane here. But I think it'll be really interesting to see how more neuromorphic solutions like this, because this is a neuromorphic solution given that it's based on a brain network, are incorporated into machine learning challenges, given that a lot of the challenges that we experience in our quest to develop artificial and general intelligence is the fact that so far we've been very good at generating narrow AI algorithms or models that work really well on specific tasks, but have not had as much luck on developing models that can take the sum of the information that it's learned from the training data and apply it to situations it's never seen before. I'll also say that one of the reasons why I chose this paper for this video, in addition to the fact that it's just a cool paper, is the fact that they actually have a collab notebook where you can try out this model yourself and see how well it performs. So if you're interested in that, I'd highly recommend checking it out, and I'll leave a link in the description so that you can go find it. And if you've gotten through this video and you want to learn more about the algorithms that are behind self-driving cars, you should check out Brilliant's videos on neural networks and machine learning. Brilliant is a website and app that makes learning accessible and fun. Their approach is based on problem solving and active learning. It's about seeing concepts visually and interacting with them, and then answering questions that get you to think. Their courses are laid out like a story and broken down to pieces so you can tackle them a little bit at a time. There's no tests and no grades, just pick a course based on what you're interested in and get started. And if you make a mistake, no big deal. Just check out the explanations to find out more. You can learn at your own pace, and there's something for everybody. Whether you want to brush up on the basics of algebra, learn programming, or learn about cutting-edge topics like neural networks. There's even some advanced stuff like differential equations if you want to keep working on the types of problems that we saw in this video. To get started, go to brilliant.org/jordan or click on the link in the description and sign up for free. In fact, the first 200 people that sign up will also get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Clicking on that link supports my channel and will give you access to an amazing library of courses, so please check them out. Otherwise, if you like this video, you can let me know by smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. You can also check out my earlier video on explainable AI, or how we develop models that we can explain in ways that humans understand. Otherwise, if you'd like to follow my PhD life, you can follow me on Twitter and Instagram, and I'll see y'all on Monday. Bye!